They're not born that way. They will burn that way. This is what God says.
Let us help you. Let's stop cursing the darkness and start shining the light. For free assistance, email us at gethelp@bornthatway.org. Thank you.
And let me encourage you to get the book, Born That Way After All, and read it. You can also read many outstanding articles on Brother Nixon's website, which is bornthatway.org.
That is exactly how I feel about the author and my friend, Johnny Nixon, and Born That Way Ministries.
Born That Way Ministries. Just by the name, you can tell there's something wrong with this ministry. Okay, Born That Way Ministry. The book that it centers around is called Born That Way After All.
What do you think when you see, here's a book, it's called Born That Way After All. What are you gonna think that's about? Who is the one pushing the, oh, we're born that way. We're born, who says that? It's the queer community, it's the sodomites. They're the ones that are making the claim, oh, we're born this way.
I'm gay. I was born gay.
It's not analysis. Are people born gay?
Our next question.
Sir, probably.
Just put your paws up, because you were born this way, baby.
They're the ones that have been pushing born that way, trying to get you to accept that this is the way that we're born, this is the way God made us, this is natural, this is normal, because we were born that way. And they come out with a book that says, Born That Way After All. You're confirming that that's true. Yes, they are born that way after all. And they say, oh, but that's not really what we're saying. Then why did you name your book that? Shouldn't we abstain from all appearance of evil, first of all? But then their spin when you read the book.
They're teaching that the homosexuals were born that way. But they weren't born to be homosexuals. They were actually born to be eunuchs. And they're just confused, that's all. They're just a little mixed up. And what it is that God just didn't give these men desire for women because he just wanted them to just be fully dedicated to him. So they're supposed to just be celibate. You know, they're just born to be celibate. And they just accidentally became a homo.
So if a person is born and doesn't have a desire for that which God created him to have a desire for, pray tell me why he'd have a desire for a septic tank. He doesn't desire that which God created, which is perfect and fit for him and designed for him and fits like a glove for him, but he wants to play in a septic tank. Do you see the stupidity of this nonsense?
So here I've got the book. You know, I just want to show you some excerpts from this book just to show you what it's about. Why am I attracted to the same sex?
This is the question I'm asked by many eunuchs.
Now, the reason why you're asked that question by so many eunuchs is because they're not eunuchs. They're sodomites, okay? They're homos. But his whole book is based on the fact that these people are actually born eunuchs, and what that means to him is that they're born without any attraction toward men or women, and then somehow they just accidentally end up being a sodomite.
The guy that he tours around with, this flaming effeminate queer that he brings around with him, that the book centers around this guy, okay? This guy went into just a full-blown sodomite lifestyle, just having relationships with multitudes of men. But it was all just because he was just confused. He didn't realize he's just a eunuch. Now, here's why that's so stupid. Because if you're supposedly a eunuch, then you wouldn't be desirous of men or women. You'd desire neither. That's the whole point of God saying, well, you know, some people are going to remain single. First of all, when he talks about people remain single, he's not saying they have no desire for the opposite gender. He's just saying that they're able to contain that desire. But what they're teaching is, well, these people are just born with no desire for man or woman. So then the obvious question is, well, then why are they being a fag then? That doesn't even make sense, because if you desire neither, then you just do neither.
And they say, no, see, there's these people that were born eunuchs, which means they don't have a desire for people of the opposite gender. And they were born that way by God. And somehow they got confused and ended up doing perverted acts with someone of the same gender just because they don't have any type of sexual attraction to anybody. Does that make any sense?
No.
Don't say that somehow a person is going to get confused and do something repulsive and do something that's going to turn the stomach of any normal person naturally, because these sins, and they won't deny it, these sins, the sin of homosexuality is against nature. It's not against nature for some, it's against nature for all.
No man just accidentally ends up with another dude because he had no desire. That's stupidity. That's foolishness. The Bible says the thought of foolishness is sin. How much more when you speak that kind of foolishness? They're trying to convince us that homos are actually eunuchs. I mean, what will they think of next?
Why am I attracted to the same sex? This is a question I'm asked by many eunuchs.
Yeah, of course that's weird to think that a eunuch would be attracted to the same sex, because a eunuch is not a sodomite. He says, number one is inherent same-sex attraction. Same-sex attraction is not exclusive. We all possess it. How do you like this quote?
This leads me to conclude that we should have biblical eunuchs of both sexes in our churches that interact with the kids.
So he wants dudes who are attracted to the same sex working with our kids. He wants to bring them in as a children's worker. That's always been the goal of this movement.
The end game for the sodomites is that this ministry basically provides for them the ability to be able to get access to children. And that's why they have an article that says seven things you don't know about eunuchs. Now keep in mind, they're not using the biblical definition of eunuch, all right? When they say eunuch, they mean, you know, seven things you don't know about a filthy animal, sodomite, homo. That's what they mean. But in their seven things you don't know about fags is what they really mean. Here, and the first thing they say is this. They say, number one, you can trust them. And then later on in the article, that what they say is this. They say, and by the way, they are excellent working with children.
Take the sodomites, right? And they're, because they don't believe that the sodomites are reprobate. So they're saying, we can reach the sodomites and get them to a life of celibacy. And then they make great children's workers.
Typically, they love working with other people and can be trusted to care for them. They are usually excellent working with children. So there you have it, folks. That is the real end game here of these sodomites creeping into churches. Why are they infiltrating? Why are they creeping in? Well, to gain access to children. Isn't it interesting that Born That Way Ministries just brings up, number one, oh, you can trust these people. And then right after that follows it up with, oh, they're great working with children. So basically, they want to just enable pedophiles to have access to children. That's how wicked this is. That's how satanic. Don't tell me I'm overreacting. These people have truly known the depths of Satan.
It's so crazy, I wouldn't even bring it up, except that I'm talking big name preachers are just embracing this. Listen, the supporting ministry, if you go to their Born That Way .org, they're supporting ministries. Who supports them? This is what it says on the top of the page. The pastors and organizations listed below are friends who understand the truth. Talking about the truth that they're teaching, that sodomites are really just poor little confused eunuchs. The pastors and organizations listed below are friends who understand the truth and provide a safe place for those seeking answers. By the way, those seeking answers are pedophiles and sodomites. Who they're painting as victims, whereas the Bible paints them as wicked, brute beasts, haters of God, full of murder, debate, deceit, malignity. Read Romans 1. Here are some of the names on the list. Dr. Bob Gray from Longview, Texas. He's a leader of the Independent Fundamental Baptist movement. There are hundreds of pastors, hundreds of Independent Baptist pastors who look up to Dr. Bob Gray Sr. as a leader of the Fundamental Baptist movement. This is what he's supporting, Born That Way Ministries. Dr. Jeff Owens, again, another big name in fundamentalism that people look to as a leader of the Fundamental Baptist movement. S.M. Davis is another well-known guy that's on here.
Several months ago now, pastor friend read where I had written that I am not a heterosexual. He became very concerned. I was scheduled to preach in his church, and he thought that maybe Dr. Davis had come out of the closet and become a homosexual. May I assure you that I'm not homosexual. In fact, the truth is this. I am not a heterosexual, and neither are you. I am not a homosexual, and neither are you. There are no heterosexuals. There are no homosexuals. There never have been. There never will be. And the whole gay marriage debacle will continue to get worse, and freedom of religion in America may die completely unless every Bible believer in America starts saying what I am saying right now. And let me encourage you to get the book, Born That Way After All, and read it. You can also read many outstanding articles on Brother Nixon's website, which is bornthatway.org.
And this website, Born That Way Ministries, it's so soft on homos, it literally says that calling yourself straight is offensive. Because if you say that you're straight, you're implying that they're crooked. Well, you know, I got news for you. The Bible has a lot worse things to say about sodomites than just that they're crooked. The Bible calls them filthy beasts, vile, sons of the devil, everything else. So this website is so soft on sodomy, it literally says, don't call yourself straight. So Bob Gray has come out supporting this ministry. Bob Gray Sr. from Longview, Texas. He came out supporting this ministry, and he put on his blog post, this is what Bob Gray said, I'm not a heterosexual. Okay, because that's what this Born That Way ministry teaches, to not say that you're straight, to not say that you're heterosexual.
And Dr. Gray, here's the thing, Dr. Gray just said he reread the book. And he said it on his blog post, he said he was sitting on a plane, he reread the book and was amazed at the truths in the book.
What Bob Gray Sr. is doing is an abomination to God. Put that in your stinking pipe and smoke
it. Amen. Yeah. Right,
he is leading people away into the... I was listening to Pastor Anderson go over that wicked book, Born That Way After All. It's so bad, it's not even funny. I couldn't believe what they were saying. And that bugger, just read the book, read the book. You know what that tells me? That he's read the book and he's okay with it.
Let me show you this part on here. This is a page on cross-dressing. Let's read some of this. Gender dysphoria, or childhood gender nonconformity, is a condition in which children and teens do not conform to expected societal behavior. Some signs and traits of this condition include cross-gender clothing and grooming preferences. Typical among those who are diagnosed includes a fascination with the clothing of the opposite sex. Even though this sometimes leads to a desire for cross-dressing, it's well reported that over 75% of these individuals identify themselves as heterosexual. Among the many major studies in this area, gender dysphoria is accepted by many medical professionals to be both physiological and psychological. Medical research also indicates that gender nonconforming behaviors are relatively treatable, such as testosterone deficiency or congenital adrenal hyperplasia. So basically, he goes on and on about cross-dressing as it's a condition, though it's a condition, or those who've been diagnosed with it, it's a condition. He's trying to make it out that it's a medical problem, okay? But it's funny because in all this talk about cross-dressing, he never tells you what the Bible says, okay? Here's the one verse in the Bible that talks about cross-dressing. It says, the woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment, for all that do so are abomination unto the Lord thy God. Notice, that does not say, as people often quote this, that it is an abomination to cross-dress, it actually says that if you cross-dress, you are an abomination, for all that do so are abomination of the Lord thy God. So, you know, man's wisdom over here of the world says, oh, it's just a medical condition. Over here it says, no, the problem is the person doing it's an abomination. Okay. But he doesn't even bring up the relevant scripture. Look what he says next. These are real world issues that are prevalent in our society today. You may recall a male celebrity athlete announcing to the world that he felt like he was truly a female. How did you respond? Many Christians voiced their opinions about his confession in a rather questionable manner. People that suffer with transgender-related issues should not be maligned or mocked. So notice what he says. They're suffering with transgender-related issues. So the Bible says they're an abomination. Johnny Nixon says, oh, they're a victim. They're suffering. And he's talking about Bruce Jenner here, whose picture in drag, cross-dressed, was on the cover of a magazine that was seen by literally over a billion people. It was everywhere in the airports and the grocery stores. Everywhere you looked, you saw that filthy picture. Your children were exposed to it. And instead of getting angry and being upset about the fact that this sodomite put his dirty picture in the minds of half of our planet, he's worried about, but how did you respond? Many Christians voice. Shut up. I don't care what you think about how Christians acted. That's a filthy picture. And he's not suffering. He's not diagnosed. He's an abomination. And friend, if you're at home and you don't agree with me, just remember, you don't agree with God. This is God's word. This is not my word. This is the devil's lies over here. One of the most telling things about this book is what it doesn't say. Just like it doesn't bring up Deuteronomy 22:5, it also conveniently never references Romans 1, where it talks about God giving them over to vile affections.
For this cause, God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change their natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burning their lust one toward another. Men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meat. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient.
He doesn't even bring that up in a whole book talking about how sodomites got that way. That's what the whole book is about. Born that way after. It's a whole book about how sodomites got that way. He conveniently never brings up that God gave them up unto vile affections. That's why the women changed the natural use and that which is against it. And likewise also the men. So God gave them up to vile affections. God gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts. God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. He just never even mentions that in a whole book about how they got that way. Because, you know, most of them, it's just that they were born eunuchs, which is not logical. Because if you're a eunuch and you have no attraction toward either gender, and that's his weird definition of a eunuch, then you wouldn't be with other dudes as a man. Or with other women as women.
The perverted community that we have seen a lot of our eunuchs go to, they are still natural eunuchs. I mean, they were created special. However, they don't know about it yet. So we've got to let them know that they do have a purpose in life.
Right. And that comes to the heart of my questions, is that you believe that the people who are driven to these or drawn to same-sex relationships were actually eunuchs.
The majority. Yes.
So what percentage would you say of these who what can you put a figure on it? You say majority.
Yeah. If I gave a figure, it'd probably be ridiculous, because it'd be like 99%, because we have met very few people that do not see themselves as natural eunuchs who are in the lifestyle.
I must make it clear that not every person who engages in unnatural behavior was born to be a eunuch. Most of those with whom I've met have been eunuchs, but there are those who merely have allowed their lust to consume them and lead them into these sinful activities. So basically he's saying that not all homos were born eunuchs. Some people just went into that for other reasons. But he's claiming that most of the homos that he's run into were born eunuchs. I mean, this is insane.
He even gives an example of his poster child, Sam, the poster child eunuch that he's got, who was recruited at a bar by another homo. So this is some guy who was supposed to be born a eunuch, and you know, he was ostracized and didn't feel like he fit in, and he found acceptance in the homosexual community. So that's why he just accidentally became a homosexual. He just accidentally started burning for other men. And but anyway, he's at this bar, and he's recruited by these homos. And he even says that when Sam was recruited, the homo that recruited Sam, he tells a story about how he picked him up in the bar and all this kind of stuff. He goes on to say, and this is what bothers me the most, he goes on to say, the homo that recruited him, it may sound sinister, but he was not sinister. He said he was just a confused eunuch also. This guy's probably just a confused eunuch. So this is a homo that's in a bar praying on other people. He's praying and recruiting, picking to, oh, he's just a confused eunuch.
So he got confused, he got backslidden, he got out of church, he went off to college, and while he's at college, this other guy invites him to a bar. And when he gets to the bar, that other guy is with a few other friends from college and says to him, hey, we believe you're gay and we're gay too. And he basically tells Sam, I want to have intercourse with you. I'm here to confront you because I'm a homo and I think you're a homo too. And I want to have intercourse with you. Okay. And then Sam, at that moment, that's like the most accepted he's ever felt. For the first time, he feels loved and accepted. So he has intercourse with the guy. Okay, that's what the book is about. And of course, you know, this is the guy who Johnny Nixon pulls him out of that and makes him into a celibate eunuch children's worker, is what he transforms him into. It would be easy for us to think that the motives of the young man who approached Sam were in some way sinister. I prefer to think he's probably just another Sam, just a bit further down the road. So even the guy who recruited Sam into a full-blown sodomite lifestyle, even the guy who sought him out, brought him to a bar, ganged up on him with other sodomites, of course, putting alcohol in him. You think that's a coincidence that he approaches him with this at a bar? The Bible says, woe unto him that giveth his neighbor drink, and puttest thy bottle to him, and makest him drunken also, that thou mayest look on their nakedness. In Habakkuk 2:15, all the pronouns are male pronouns. It's a dude giving another dude alcohol to look on a dude's nakedness. Habakkuk 2:15 is referring to homos giving alcohol to other homos to look on their nakedness. But according to Nixon, that is in no way sinister. It'd be easy for us to think that the motives of the young man who approached Sam were in some way sinister. He's saying they weren't sinister at all. He's just another confused eunuch. He's probably just another. So even just the sodomite recruiters who are taking people who've never done it and enticing them into that lifestyle through alcohol, they're not even sinister. They're just victims of gender nonconformity disorder. We just haven't diagnosed them and yada, yada, yada.
Eunuch is just code word for sodomite. I'll prove it to you because he says that most homos are eunuchs. This is what he says. He said most homosexuals are just eunuchs. So eunuch is just his word for sodomite. Anytime I say eunuch, you might as well just fill in the blank, just sodomite. All right, so he says, one of the ways you can tell a eunuch is that they're flamboyant and fashion conscious. So he's trying to say they're eunuchs because God created them that way. So he's saying God created them with a flamboyance and fashion conscience. Now I've got a word for that. If you're a man and you're into name brands other than Carhartt and Dickies and Levi's and you're fascist conscious and you're flamboyant, I got a word for that. It's called effeminate. It's called a sissy. And God says that's a sin. So why would God create somebody who's just the purpose is supposed to serve God? Oh, but now they're just Mr. Fashion Police. They're just Mr. into the latest, greatest fashions and flamboyance and name brand. Why is God going to create somebody for that nonsense? That's a sin. Amen. He says most homos are eunuchs. Now, just think about the nonsense of this.
So this chapter right here has to do with how to identify these eunuchs in your church. He said, you know, these people that God created with no desire sexually for either men or women, these wonderful, special servants of God that God created, they're born that way. He tells you, you know, these are some signals to look for to identify these special eunuchs so that you can help them and counsel them. Does he sometimes exhibit flamboyance? One characteristic many eunuchs have, which is often seen in the so-called homosexual lifestyle, is a combination of quiet nobility and flamboyance. So when he looks at the fags of our world, he says they exhibit quiet nobility and flamboyance. They like flashy colors and they enjoy the things that we may often equate with femininity. Are they touchy-feely individuals? And then he says, is his appearance important to him? Does he desire to be seen as lovely? Does he like to wear bright clothing and colors that are more often associated with women? A eunuch may be extremely fashion conscious. Physical appearance is extremely important to them. So the thing that's so weird about this is that he literally is trying to expect us to believe that the fact that God supposedly made these men to be special, undistracted servants of him that don't get married and just are fully dedicated to serving him. So why would God create them fashion conscious? Can you explain that to me? So born that way after all, you really were to be born to be fashion conscious. I mean, what is this guy's favorite TV show, Queer Eye for the Straight Guy?
Is a person that's natural born eunuch more prone to a same-sex type relationship? And I would say yes, and it has to do with what you talked about this morning. It has to do with intimacy. All of us had this intimacy when we were young, especially guys. We lived to be around our friends until something happened with some of us. And a part of that intimacy, which is not sexual at all, it's closeness, diverts over to the females. Well, guess what? It never diverted for the natural eunuch. He has more of a desire for an intimacy and closeness than we do. So, and a part of that, believe it or not, revolves around touch. We as human beings we're perfected by touch. And like Jesus and John, where John and Jesus touched each other.
Two eunuchs, and remember, this is his code word for basically men who are attracted to other men and men who formerly have actually had sex with other men. Two eunuchs of the same sex can develop a wonderful and chaste relationship with one another that is in no way sexual or romantic. Two eunuch men or women can live together in chastity as long as they remain mentally pure and avoid any appearance of evil. So basically, these former, quote-unquote, former sodomites that he wants to bring in, these men who are attracted to other men that he claims were born that way because they were born eunuchs, he wants to bring them in, make them children's workers, and he's even saying they can live with another eunuch dude. So these two couple of queers, basically, he calls them eunuchs, but he's talking about men who lust after other men, can live together, be in church, living together with their partner, but just as long as they're celibate, as long as they're chaste, you know. Yeah, and how are we going to know that? We're supposed to just take their word for it that they're celibate now as they live with their gay buddy, okay? You can develop strong emotional same-sex ties, but it may be wise not to share a living place or to show open affection too often. So, you know, it might be wise not to if people are freaking out. And don't show open affection too often towards one another. He's talking about your eunuch same-sex partner that you live with. Okay. What does the Bible say? Well, the Bible says a man leaves father and mother and cleaves unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. And of course, there's also the option given of a man just remaining single, like the Apostle Paul or other people in the Bible who remain single. Nobody's teaching that people have to get married. That's a straw man. 1 Corinthians 7 talks about how you don't have to get married if you don't want to. If you can handle being single and serve God, great. But he wants these people living with their eunuch buddy. And he says, don't show open affection too often toward one another. So save all the cuddling with your eunuch buddy, save that for behind closed doors. Just don't do it openly too often. Sometimes do it openly, but not too often. And you may not want to share a living place if it's going to offend people.
I believe there's a conspiracy today in the independent fundamental Baptist movement to bring these sons of Belial into churches. So here's what Johnny Nixon and his partner, you know, Joshua, whatever his name is, Joshua Agin, you know, they decided, hey, Let's make a ministry where we trick all these pastors to go out and purposely look for perverts and bring them in. And then let's teach them, hey, the number one thing you need to know about these people is you can trust them with your children. Put them in the Sunday school class. Put them in that Sunday school class by themselves, you know, with Johnny Nixon and Joshua and whoever, you know, put them in there because you can trust them and the best place, they are excellent. They are excellent working with children.
They're trying to sneak these people in by calling them eunuchs, and they're saying, hey, let's just bring these homos in. Let's just teach them that, hey, you're not gay after all. You're not a homo. You're just born a eunuch, and that you should have no desire for the opposite sex. And here, let's just bring you in, and let you work with the children. Listen, that is sick. That is disgusting. Listen, we need to guard our children. And the reason why I'm preaching on this morning, I'm going to preach so hard against it, is out of love for the people of this church and out of love for your children. Because I'm not going to let some molester, child molester, rapist, some homo come in here and do things against your child. They're not welcome in this church. You hear me?
And this is what this just gets me real fired up when I hear this dumb argument. It blows me away. Here's the argument.
We do background checks at our church. Oh,
right. I mean, it's just like...
We do background checks.
Okay. Well, did you know that the average pedophile molests 260 victims in his lifetime? Now, if they're getting arrested every time they do it, or most of the time they do it, or even a tenth of the time they do it, they wouldn't get to 260 victims. You know how they get to 260 victims? Because they molest scores of victims before getting caught. Usually when you hear about these pedophiles getting caught, it's like 20 years later. It's like, oh, 20 years ago he molested this person, and then they came out, and then 12 other victims came out. Isn't there always just a whole line of victims that come out? Oh, once she came forward, 10 other people came forward. And it's 15 years ago, 17 years ago. How in the world can the average pedophile molest 260 victims unless they're getting away with it all the time? So you know what? The background check tells you nothing. It just tells you they haven't been caught yet. That doesn't guarantee it. Everybody does it for the first time. Think about that. Every murderer kills their first person. Every thief steals something for the first time. Every drunk took their first drink, right? And every pedophile molested a kid for the first time.
Oh, but the background check was clean.
Yeah, that's because 8 years later they're going to get caught. And then once it's too late, once lives have been destroyed, once irreparable damage is done to babies and children, then it's like, oh, turns out this guy was a pervert.
A homo is as kin to a pedophile as a puppy is a dog. If a homo is not a pedophile, it's just because he hasn't matured to be a full-grown beast yet. It's just because he hasn't had the opportunity yet. He hasn't had the opportunity to recruit a child. Now, I'm going to prove to you that homos are pedophiles. First point, the way I'm going to prove to you homos are pedophiles are the cries of Sodom.
And the Lord said, because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grievous, I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether according to the cry of it.
So whose cries do you think God's hearing? Who's crying from Sodom to grasp the attention of the Lord Jesus Christ? The Bible says the sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord, but the prayer of the upright is his delight. The Lord is far from the wicked, but he heareth the prayer of the righteous. So do you think it was the wicked people in Sodom that Jesus Christ came down to answer their prayers, or he heard their prayers? No! It's their children that these brute beasts are messing with. It's their children that they're raping and they're crying out at night. Oh, Jesus, help me! A dog's got me! Help me, Jesus! And he's coming down. He's coming down to help him. He's coming down because he hates somebody who would hurt a little child so much. He's coming down to put him in hell early. Right. He's coming down to put him in hell early and burn him alive with fire and brimstone. Number one, homos are pedophiles because of the cries. Jesus heard the cries of these children. I mean, what other cries is he going to hear? It says he hears their cry, the cry of the fatherless child and the widow, his ears are open and sensitive to their cries. Their cries is what prompted the call to earth. Number two, homos are pedophiles because young and old. Turn to Genesis 19:4.
But before they lay down, the men of the city, even the men of Sodom, compassed the house round, both old and young, all the people from every quarter. And they called unto Lot and said unto him, where are the men which came into thee this night? Bring them out unto us that we may know them.
How could you be a young person and be so perverted and be so vile? How can you be that despicable and that filth of the earth? How can you be a young person and be that way? I tell you how, because they were recruited. They were messed with as a child. They had some sodomite plant a seed in their mind and expose themselves in a restroom to them or whatever. Touch them and show them graphic materials that they shouldn't be looking at. Show them pictures of things that they shouldn't be looking at and get in their mind and mess with their mind and recruit them, because that's what the agenda is. That is what the whole agenda of Born That Way After All Ministries is. Satan's behind it. He's trying to bring these homos into churches to plant seeds in kids' minds, to mess with kids, to confuse kids, and recruit them over to that side. And when they get messed with and they get recruited, they get bitter, they get hard-hearted, they get tired of God rebuking them and reproving them, and they get harder, and they stiffen their neck to God, and they reject Him, and they reject Him, and Jesus Christ finally gives them over. And that's how they become that way. So we see young and old. It's obvious that they recruit. If they didn't recruit, then why is there young people? This isn't natural for a young person to want to do. They had to be taught this. They had to be recruited.
If we look at stories, there are three stories in the Bible that involve sodomy, that involve men who commit acts with other men. They're found in Genesis 9, Genesis 19, and Judges 19. They all involve violating someone against their will. They are all horrible stories of violence. They're all consistent in what they teach. Now, the Bible is painting a very negative picture of this so-called segment of our population, because the Bible is saying that they're vile. The Bible is saying they're disgusting. The Bible is saying that they're reprobate. The Bible says they hate God. The Bible says that they are filled with murder and malignity and maliciousness and violence, and that they're basically rapists and predators and hurting people.
And number four, we know homos are pedophiles because the Bible says, God says, that he that burns for his lust to another man, or even the same sex, is filled with all unrighteousness.
For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burning their lust one toward another. Men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meat. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness.
Now, is pedophilia unrighteousness or not? If pedophilia is unrighteousness, then God said they're filled with it. That means they're capable of it. They're capable of anything. And here's the reason why. Because a reprobate has their conscience seared with a hot iron. Doesn't bother them. Nothing bothers them. They're filled with all unrighteousness. They're filled with pedophilia. God said it. He said they're filled with all unrighteousness. And the fifth reason that I'm going to tell you that the Bible teaches us that homos are pedophiles is because God calls them dogs. God calls them dogs. Now, if you know anything about a dog will hump anything that breathes and not breathes. Pastor Anderson said he recently had a dog and they had to get rid of him because he was just weird. I mean, just humping everything, even like the couch and everything else. And they just, it was too weird. They got rid of him. Deuteronomy 23:17. There shall be no whore of the daughters of Israel, nor a sodomite of the sons of Israel. Thou shalt not bring the hire of a whore or the price of a dog into the house of the Lord thy God for any vow, for even both these are an abomination unto the Lord. Now, it doesn't take a rocket scientist, it doesn't take a theologian to see that Jesus Christ, that God here is using a dog interchangeably with a sodomite. Jesus says, give not that which is holy to dogs, neither cast your pearls before swine, lest they rend you. The reason why homos are pedophiles is because God said they're dogs, and a dog will hump anything that breathes. They go any kind of way. Any kind of way. Because they'll hump anything that breathes.
I just want to just expose a big lie tonight that's out there. And this is a lie that the world will teach you. But now the Baptists are repeating the same thing with this born that way philosophy. Okay. Here's what's going on. The Bible, and turn if you would to Leviticus 20:13, because I want to show it to you from Leviticus 20:13. Because there's a key word that I think that people sometimes overlook in this passage, and it's important that we get our beliefs from the Bible, not from the world around us. Okay, so let's look at Leviticus 20:13, because there's a key word here. Watch this. Third book in the Bible. Everybody turn there. It says, if a man, what's the next word?
Also.
If a man also. Does it say if a man do this instead? No. It says if a man also. If a man also lie with mankind, as he lieth with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination, they shall surely be put to death, their blood shall be upon them. This does not say that the homo only lies with men. This says that he also lies with other men, as he lieth with woman. You see, every time you see the stories of the sodomites in the Bible, they always go both ways, every single time. One of the key stories on this subject is a story in Judges chapter 19, where it describes the sodomites as certain sons of Belial. Belial is the devil. So the sons of the devil, and by the way, once you're a child of God, how long are you a child of God for? Well, guess what? Once you're a child of the devil, guess how long you're a child of the devil for? Forever. That's when you are twofold more the child of hell. That's when you're twice dead, as the Bible says. That's when you are given over to a reprobate mind. But it says a man also lie with mankind. Well, in Judges chapter 19, there's that horrific story where the sodomites surround the house and they want to violate the men inside. And they say, bring out that man that came unto you. We want to know him. In the biblical sense, like Adam knew Eve and she conceived and brought forth a son. So they say, we want to know him. And the man that he's staying with says, don't do such a vile thing. Notice that word vile. Don't do so vile a thing. And instead, what they do is they take the guy's concubine, his live-in girlfriend. You know, the concubine is not a wife. It's basically someone that you lie with that's not your wife. So this is what we would call your live-in girlfriend, your bed buddy, okay? They take this guy's concubine and they throw her out of the house and slam the door and say, abuse her instead of abusing him. They toss her out to them, and the Bible says that the sodomites, they abused her until the morning. So they didn't say like, ooh, gross, we don't like women, ooh. You know what I mean? Oh, don't you know we're not attracted to women? We were born without that desire. Oh, no, they're just like, they just took her as the consolation prize. And they abused her all night. You say, well, that's a disgusting story. It is, but it's the Word of God. And you know what's even more disgusting is when you don't know that story and you have to deal with this stuff in real life. See, those of us that are smart will read the disgusting story because God put it in there for a reason. We need to hear it. It's not graphic in the Bible, thank God. It's not graphic, but it's showing us reality because it's always better to read the Word of God and just trust it than to have to bring these people in and see what they're like firsthand, which is what the independent Baptists are experimenting with right now, to their own confusion. And to the confusion of their children's nakedness. And so what we see here is that in Judges 19, they go both ways, okay? What about the story of Sodom and Gomorrah itself? In the story of Sodom and Gomorrah itself, It teaches that all the men of the city, and it's very repetitive to tell us that everybody was there. All the men of the city, every single person other than Lot, is a homo in Sodom. Because they all come and surround the house and say, bring these men out to us that we may know them. But yet it talks about there being little children in the city. Because it talks about young and old, great and small. That tells me that they're producing children with women. Because two dudes can't produce a child. So therefore, the men of Sodom must have clearly gone both ways in order to produce these children. And then if we go back to the story of Genesis chapter 9, where we see Ham, the Bible doesn't give us the detail, but he looked upon his father's nakedness, which is often, you know, uncovering the nakedness is a euphemism in the Bible, sort of like lie with or to know them, to uncover the nakedness. You know, some perverted act there. Well, we know Ham had children, so he clearly went both ways as well. So every time we see them in the Bible, what the world would call them is bi. Right? Isn't that what the world would tell you? Well, they're bi. But here's the thing. According to the Bible, they're all bi. They all go both ways. But why? Because it's the man who also lies with mankind. And see, they didn't just completely leave the use of the woman. They left the natural use of the woman. And let me ask you this. Can you leave the natural use of the woman if you've never used the woman? Look, in order to leave somewhere, you have to have been there. I can't say, well, I left Faithful Word Baptist Church. You ever been there? No. So how can you leave the natural use of the woman if you've never been there? They left the natural use of the woman. They lie also with mankind as they've lain with women. But we're supposed to believe this lie that the world tells us, oh, these sodomites, they're not attracted to women. That's the lie that's out there. They have no desire for women. They never have. They never did, according to the world. So who should I believe, the Bible or them, or the world? There's nothing like that in the Bible. But yet, this born that way movement says, oh, well, these people are born eunuchs, and they don't desire either men or women. So then they just end up getting confused and accidentally being with a bunch of dudes by accident. Whoops. Now, look, you accidentally make a wrong turn at an intersection. You accidentally pour cream on your cereal instead of milk. Right? You accidentally slip on a banana peel. You do not accidentally be intimate with multitudes of other men because you're a little confused. Okay, that's a lie out of the pit of hell. And what it all comes down to is this. The fundamental Baptists, they want to meet the sodomites halfway. Well, okay, you guys are born that way, but you got to be celibate, though, because you're born eunuchs. Stupid, I know. I don't even want to repeat it. But, you know, we'll kind of meet you halfway. Like, okay, we get it. Yeah, you're not attracted to women, blah, blah, blah. No, wrong. That's not what the Bible teaches. Get your head out of TV and Hollywood and the magazines that are teaching you that stuff. Get in the Word of God and read the Scripture for yourself. Read Genesis 19, read Judges 19, read Leviticus 20:13, read Romans 1. They left the use of the woman. They did both, according to the Bible. That's what Scripture actually teaches. So this whole thing is just a fraud through and through.
And then he claims that the standard answer when children ask their parents, what does it mean to be gay? Gay is when a man does not like girls. Why would any parent give their child such a stupid, ridiculous answer? No, gay is when a man is into other dudes. It's not when he doesn't like girls. It's, again, the straw man of the entire book.
It makes them into a victim. And all over this Born That Way website, there are all kinds of articles telling us how we need to love the sodomite and how we should never even call them a sodomite. I'm using the word sodomite. They call them gay and things like that on the article. There's a whole article on there saying that it's wrong to call them sodomites. And they said, but you'll say the Bible said sodomite. And here's what they say on this Born That Way Ministries. They said, well, even though the Bible calls them sodomites, we shouldn't because it's offensive and it's not edifying. And then they say, well, I know Jesus called people serpents and vipers, but it's okay for him to do it, but it's not okay for us to do it. I thought he left us an example that we should follow in his steps. Right? But we're supposed to be better than Jesus. Because Jesus was mean and a jerk and rude, according to them. We need to be better than Jesus. We need to be softer and nicer, because he was just too mean. I mean, sure, he called people serpents and vipers, but he also walked on water. Are you going to walk on water? And then they say, well, Jesus never commanded us to walk on water, and he never commanded us to preach like that. Actually, he did. He said, preach the word, rebuke. What do you think rebuke is? It's to sternly tell someone that they're wrong. The Bible says, rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in the faith. Hard preaching in the Old Testament, hard preaching in the New Testament. It's always been God's style of preaching. Rough preaching, hard preaching is biblical. Smooth preaching is for false prophets. That's what the Bible teaches. But this ministry to, oh, don't call them sodomites. You know, I mean, look, God forbid you'd actually call them a fag or a queer, but they're saying don't even call them a sodomite. Don't even call, and don't have this us against them mentality. Embrace them, bring them in.
Calling sin by name has morphed into calling sinners names. Many preachers are caught up in the rhetoric of words that once would have been deemed as acceptable, but now is considered hate speech. So notice he says that it once would have been deemed as acceptable. That's pretty interesting, because earlier in the book, he tells a story about going to youth conference, and he doesn't name the names, but it's obvious what he's talking about because he gives exact quotes from Jeff Owen's youth conference sermon. The sermon's called Struck Blind. It was preached at youth conference at First Baptist Church of Hammond, Indiana. He tells the story. Ironically, Johnny Nixon was actually there for that sermon. I remember as a teenager attending a youth conference, and that's at First Baptist Church of Hammond, and hearing a message preached on being a true Christian man. The preacher brought a powerful message, and much of what he said was spot on. I remember one particular part of that sermon quite vividly. In it, he used incredibly strong language to condemn gay men. He called them names and made violent threats. He said that real men should banish homosexuals to non-existence. He even said that AIDS was a curse sent from God. Of course, the preacher was Jeff Owens. The sermon was called Struck Blind. I'm the one who uploaded it to YouTube years later. Before I knew it, I was so caught up in the moment that I was standing and shouting, "Praise the Lord!" I could hardly believe that was me because it was totally out of character for me, but it all sounded so good at the moment. Clearly, this kind of preaching often takes things way too far, and much of what he said was rhetoric and not what he actually believed. In fact, to his credit, the preacher who preached this message apologized publicly a few years later for the hurtful language and the suggestions of violence in his sermon.
This is Jeff Owens. If you're responding to a sermon that I preached about gays, I would like to render the following apology. Nearly 15 years ago, I preached a sermon that promoted physically hurting gay people. I was young, stupid, and very immature. I didn't even hold to the belief of hurting people when I wrongfully made those comments. I regret those words and have asked God to forgive me for them over and over again. I'm not a believer in the gay lifestyle, but I was profoundly wrong in making any comments about hurting people. If I could retract the words, I certainly would.
In America, we need to stop burning flags and start burning fags. It's about time somebody said what needs to be said. It's vile, it's reprobate, and AIDS is a curse sent from God. It's a curse sent from God. You say, well, you shouldn't say that. Well, don't you say it. I will. It's my turn. We need Hunt a Homo Week. We do. You know that? Straighten it up. Just put it on television, brother. Put it on television. That put them back in the closet. I'm going to tell you something. Those of you that are yelling and screaming and shouting, the reason they came out of the closet because there weren't enough men on the other side of the closet to keep them in. You'd be a man. We wouldn't have that problem. You know, we just take them all out and shoot them with a scatter shotgun.
I no longer preach like that, and I purposely teach and train others to preach and behave properly as well. The hurtful words in that sermon tape were erased many years ago and somehow have resurfaced, much to my disappointment and embarrassment.
However, and this is the key, that was pretty much how we all felt about it at the time. We knew homosexuality was wrong and perverted, and not only that, it was unnatural to us, okay? I mean, think about this.
There were thousands of people at that sermon. Youth Conference is a huge event at First Baptist Church of Hammond. Thousands of people were there. And if you listen to the recording of Jeff Owens preaching that sermon, you can hear the whole place is shouting amen. You know, if you listen real carefully on the tape, you'll even hear Johnny Nixon shouting amen. Okay. Because they all, but what's funny is he admits that in the mid-90s, because that sermon I think was preached around 94, 96, somewhere around there. In the mid-90s, we all felt that way about it at the time. Okay, so what's the difference 20 years later? Could it be 20 years of brainwashing and Hollywood programming and TV programming and the media cramming this down our throat? So according to Johnny Nixon, all of us were wrong back then. Everybody who was at that youth conference and cheering and carrying on, everybody was wrong. Here's what I want to know. Why did no one have a problem with Jeff Owens' sermon when he preached it? Why didn't anybody tell him at the time, hey, you know, you need to not say that? Why didn't he apologize at the time? I uploaded that to YouTube, and the sodomites persecuted Jeff Owens. That's when he apologized. The reason he didn't apologize in the 90s is because in the 90s, that was normal preaching, and nobody was offended. Nobody batted an eye. Nobody cared. Now, all of a sudden, it's hate speech, according to him. And back then, he knew homosexuality was wrong and perverted. And not only that, it was unnatural to us. Well, you know what? I'm still in that 90s time frame of mentality. You know what I mean? It's funny how now these preachers, Jeff Owens, Bob Gray, Johnny Nixon, they're promoting this garbage. And then they even call me an idiot and you're crazy, your preaching's insane. But it's identical to what they preached in the 90s. And he said, look, we all felt that way about it at the time. So these guys have changed with the times and they expect us to go right down the tube with them. My position on homosexuality was pretty standard. It was a sin. It was a sin and an abomination to the Lord.
What these people are doing is turning our country into a modern day Sodom and Gomorrah. That's what they're doing to our country. And they don't care. They don't care. If they cared, they'd do something to stop it, my friend. If they loved me, if they love, they talk so much about love, they only love themselves.
That's right.
Because if they loved me, and if they loved you, and if they loved our children, you know what they'd do? They would try to stop our country from turning into a modern day Sodom and Gomorrah. That's what they would do if they really loved us. They don't love us. Otherwise, explain this, huh? Why don't you explain to me why the leaders of the Fundamental Baptist Movement are supporting Born That Way ministries and, oh, don't say sodomites. That's it. You offend me. You offend me with your queer-loving doctrine. You offend me with your watered-down compromise. They wouldn't touch Romans 1 with a 10-foot pole. They're scared of it because they love money.
I finally figured out the real reason why Bob Gray is so vehemently defending this wicked ministry, Born That Way Ministries, these bunch of perverts and this wicked doctrine. Well, it's because he's involved in this Independent Baptist Online College. And it turns out that Johnny Nixon, the founder of this faggoty ministry, this Born That Way Ministries, is the Bible teacher on his Independent Baptist Online College. If you go to their website and look at their faculty, you know, lists about 17, 18 different teachers, and under Bible instruction, Bible teacher, you'll see Johnny Nixon there listed. So, you know, this whole Independent Baptist Online College is a scam anyway. It's just basically a money-making scam. Well, I came across a video where vice president of the college, David Baker, who, by the way, is also buddies with Johnny Nixon and just everything Johnny Nixon's doing on Facebook, he's clicking like on all this Born That Way filth. But anyway, this video by David Baker, he's explaining how to start your own chapter of the online Bible college for your local church. So basically what you do is you get the young people in your church to sign up for online Bible college. And so they stay at your church. They don't have to go off to college. They can stay in your church because you have like a satellite of the online Bible college that you run out of your church. So it's all done locally with you there, with your college students. And, you know, this is just a way for them to get a lot more students for their online Bible college. So Bob Gray is traveling every week and promoting this everywhere he goes, trying to get all the pastors that he preaches for to set up this online chapter. Well, you can't believe what a scam this is. And you'll hear it explained even from David Baker's own mouth. But basically, here's what they're telling pastors. You know, you can make money off this as a pastor. Because what you'll do as a pastor who has an online chapter of this, you'll video record yourself teaching a class. And then basically your church members will have to pay $100 to watch that class. Okay, so instead of pastors now just teaching their people the Bible, instead pastors will just video record themselves teaching and then charge their people $100 a person to get that teaching. Okay, now this is what is so ridiculous about it, okay, is that of that $100 that they pay per class, or if it's a two-credit class, they pay $200 a class. If it's a three-credit class, they pay $300 and so forth. It's $100 per credit. The thing that's so weird about this is that the pastor who creates the videos, right, the pastor who does the teaching, he gets 30% of the money. So he gets $30. And then $70 goes to David Baker and friends, you know, their ministry, Independent Baptist Online College. So basically, instead of me as a pastor just teaching the Bible to my church people, I'm supposed to go to an empty room somewhere and just record myself teaching. The example he gives is personal evangelism class or soul winning. So I'm just going to talk into a camera and explain how to do personal evangelism, how to do soul winning. And instead of just letting my people watch that, uploading that to YouTube, handing them a DVD, I'm gonna send that to David Baker so that he can send it back to my people for $100 a person. Okay, so basically, I take a video that I already have in my possession that I taught, I send it to him, and then he sends it back to my church members so that I can get $30 and he can get $70 for that transaction. Shouldn't we as pastors just be willing to teach our people everything they need to know from the Bible for free? Why would I charge money to my own church members, $30, for me to teach them how to go soul winning? Shouldn't I be willing to just give them that teaching for free? And why does he get $70? The whole thing is a scam and a fraud.
So a class that you teach, then we're going to pay you 30% of the tuition that comes in for that. And so if you teach a two-credit course and 100 people take your class, that's $6,000 that we get to give to you. And that class will be taught every semester. Anytime anyone takes that class, then you'll be able to get paid for that. The other thing is this. If you have a class that you really want to teach, that you want your students to get, I use the illustration of personal evangelism. I taught personal evangelism in the college. And so if you wanted your students to have your personal evangelism class, then you can record it and your students can take your personal evangelism class.
You know what? I thought that pastors already get a paycheck from their local church. I'm not against pastors getting paid. I'm all for pastors getting paid. But are we supposed to conceal our Bible preaching, conceal our teachings, conceal personal evangelism 101? Unless you pay $100, $70 of which goes to him, and $30 goes to me. Because if I play my cards right, 100 people take my class, I can get $6,000, and Baker can get $14,000. You know, and I'm not saying it all goes to Baker, but it goes to their ministry. Or whoever his buddies are, you know, Bob Gray and Smale and Baker and Johnny Nixon or whoever is into this thing. So anyway, just wanted to just break that down to you, just how insane this is to charge money to, and by the way, if you want to learn how to go soul winning, why don't you go online and watch Brother Roger Jimenez's soul winning seminar? It's free. He's not charging his people $100 a pop to watch it. You know, where $70 goes to some other guy. It doesn't even make sense, folks. And so, the love of money is the root of all evil. And I knew that when you see this evil teaching of Johnny Nixon and Born That Way Ministries and this Born a Eunuch doctrine being promoted, there had to be some. You always got to follow the money. And here's where the money trail leads. Johnny Nixon is part of this online Baptist college. He's the Bible instructor, one of the 8 Bible instructors that they list on their website. And so, you know, that's what's going on.
With this pastor, we would like you to be able to record your own classes. Every pastor that's been around for a while has taught a Wednesday night Bible study, and when you got done, you said, "Wow, Lord, this was really good. You gave me some great information. Boy, I'd love to get this out to other people." But how? There's really not a platform to be able to go somewhere and teach for 6 months what God gave you in that Wednesday night Bible study. Well, now you do. Pastor, we would like you to record that and for that to be a class that we offer in our college. Your students can take it and our whole college can take it. And we will pay you to do that.
It's all just a money-making scam. Bob Gray is the head of it. He's the chancellor of this, the emperor, you know? He's the chancellor of this online Bible college. And his Bible teacher is Johnny Nixon. So if you want to get a Bible college degree where your Bible instruction comes from a guy that thinks that the eunuchs in the Bible are actually homos, that teaches that homos are just eunuchs and won't teach what Romans 1 teaches. And if you want your Bible instructor to be a guy who is teamed up with Phil Robertson from Duck Dynasty, who is Church of Christ and believes in baptismal regeneration, and if you want your Bible teacher to be a guy who posts pictures of Jesus molten images on his Facebook timeline as being beautiful, well then, you know, Independent Baptist Online College is for you. And if you believe that homosexuals really are born that way after all, like the title of Johnny Nixon's book, well then, Independent Baptist Online College is where you can go.
The Bible reads in Romans 1:24, "Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient."
It was their choice. They heard the truth and they hated it. Verse 27, it says, "And likewise also the man, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men working that which is unseemly." They burn in their lust. They become a reprobate. God gave them over. God gave up on them, and they will burn that way eternally. They were not born that way. They had to choose it, accept it, and now they're trying to normalize it.
You know, the Bible's really clear on salvation. It's not based on how good you are. A lot of people think they're pretty good, you know, and yeah, they're going to get to heaven because they're pretty good. But the Bible says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." The Bible says, "As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one." I'm not righteous, you're not righteous. And if it were our goodness that would get us into heaven, none of us would be going. Because the Bible even says in Revelation 21:8, it says, "But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and sorcerers and whoremongers and idolaters," and listen to this, "and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." I've lied before. Everybody's lied before. So we've all sinned and we've done stuff worse than lying, let's face it. We all deserve hell. But the Bible says, "But God commandeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." And so Jesus Christ, because he loves us, came to this earth. The Bible says he was God manifest in the flesh. God basically took on human form. He lived a sinless life. He did not commit any sin. And of course, they beat him and spit on him and nailed him to the cross. The Bible says that when he was on that cross, he himself bare our sins in his own body
on the tree. So every sin you've ever done, every sin I've ever done, it was as if Jesus had done it. He was being punished for our sins. And then, of course, they took his body when he died. They took his body and buried it in the tomb. And his soul went down to hell for 3 days and three nights, Acts 2:31. 3 days later, he rose again from the dead. He showed unto the disciples the holes in his hands. And the Bible's really clear that Jesus did die for everybody. It says that he died not for our sins only, but also for the sins of the whole world. But there's something that we must do to be saved. The Bible says, it has that question in Acts 16, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved in thy house. And that's it. He didn't say, join a church and you'll be saved, get baptized and you'll be saved, live a good life and you'll be saved, repent of all your sins and you'll be saved. No, he said, believe. And even the most famous verse in the whole Bible that's written on the bottom, I mean, the reference is written on the bottom of the cup at In-N-Out Burger. I mean, it's so famous, everybody's heard of it, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And everlasting means everlasting, means forever. And Jesus said, I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. The Bible says in John 6:47, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. So if you believe on Jesus Christ, the Bible says you have everlasting life. You're going to live forever. You can't lose your salvation. It's eternal. It's everlasting. Once you're saved, once you believe on him, you're saved forever. And no matter what, you can never lose your salvation. Even if I were to go out and commit some awful sin, God will punish me for it on this earth. If I went out and killed somebody today, you know, God's going to make sure I get punished. I'm going to prison or far worse or the death penalty. Whatever this earth punishes me, and God's going to make sure I get punished even more. But I'm not going to hell. There's nothing I can do to go to hell because I'm saved. And if I went to hell, God lied because he promised that whoever believeth in him has everlasting life. And he said, whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. That's why there are a lot of examples of people in the Bible who did some really bad stuff, yet they made it to heaven. How? Because they were so good? No, it's because they believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. Their sins are forgiven. Other people who may have lived a better life in the world's eyes, or maybe even really they lived a better life, they don't believe in Christ. They're going to have to go to hell to be punished for their sins. And let me just close on this one thought. One thing that I wanted to be sure and bring up today is that there was a question that was asked to Jesus by one of his disciples. And that question was this: are there few that be saved? That's a good question, right? I mean, are most people saved? Or is it few that are saved? Now, who here thinks that most people are going to heaven? Most people in this world are going to heaven. Yeah, guess what the answer was? He said, in Matthew 7, for example, he said, enter ye in at the straight gate. He said, because wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat, because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. And then he went on to say this. He said, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. And so you see, there are people out there. First of all, the majority of this world doesn't even claim to believe in Jesus. Thankfully, the majority of this classroom claims to believe in Jesus. Okay, but the majority of the world does not claim to believe in Jesus. But God warned that even amongst those who claim to believe in Jesus, even amongst those that call him Lord, many will be saying to him, "What? We did all these wonderful works. Why aren't we saved?" He's going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. That's because salvation is not by works. And if you're trusting your own works to save you, if you think you're going to heaven because you've been baptized, or if you think I think you have to live a good life. I think you have to keep the commandments to be saved. I think you have to go to church. I think you got to, you know, turn from your sins. You know, if you're trusting in your works, Jesus is going to say to you one day, depart from me, I never knew you. You have to have all your faith in what he did. You have to put your faith in what Jesus did on the cross when he died for you, he's buried and rose again. That's your ticket into heaven. If you're trusting all the things, oh, I'm going to heaven because I'm such a good Christian and I do all these wonderful things. He's going to say, depart from me. And notice what he said. Depart from me, I never knew you. Not I used to know you. Because once he knows you, remember I mentioned this earlier, it's everlasting, it's eternal. Once he knows you, you're saved forever. But he's going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. Because if you go to hell, it's because he never knew you. Because once he knows you, he knows you. It's just like my children will always be my children. You know, when you're born again, when you're his child, you'll always be his child. You may be the black sheep of the family. You know, you may be somebody who gets disciplined by God heavily on this earth. You can screw up your life down here, but you can't screw that up. You know, you're saved. It's a done deal. And so that's the main thing that I wanted to present to you about the end times. And we do have just a few minutes for questions about either salvation or about the end times.